in Guelph on this August 9th. Looks like a lovely day again in Guelph, and I hope it is wherever you are tuning in from as well. I welcome you here. I'm Rafe Blackman, the rector. I want to tell you who's here with me today. We have Jerry Manning on the organ and piano, and Ian Dickinson is our choral soloist. Elizabeth Adams is here as our reader, and we have Laura Keller here doing our production work. And Tony Atia, our sexton, is here. He'll be cleaning up and making sure everything is safely sanitized as we move through the place and leave later. I need to let you know it was nice to hear the organ this morning, because on Friday, Jerry found out it wasn't working. Can you imagine an organist opening up the console and nothing connects? And it was in the digital works inside, so fortunately we were able to get that repaired and it's back, and we found the problem. But that's like an organist's nightmare, to open up and nothing works, no sound. So we're gathered here in the presence of our God, and as always we like to acknowledge that we meet on land that at the time of contact was held by the Attawadaron as an area of trade and ceremony by the two rivers. At various times, the land was occupied by both the Haudenosaunee from the south and the Anishinaabe from the north. In more recent times, the Huron Treaty gave rights to the Mississaugas of New Credit. May we who dwell on or visit this land also be good stewards and honor those who came before us. Let us now focus our hearts and minds as we're gathered together in the presence of the night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and one mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. And I invite you to join with me in praying the calling for this day. Through the storms of life, O God, you walk with your people in the person of Jesus. Calm our fears and strengthen our faith, so that we may never doubt his presence among us, but proclaim that he is your Son, risen from the dead, living forever.
Reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Moses writes concerning the righteousness that comes from the law, that the person who does these things will live by them. But the righteousness that comes from faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is, to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is, to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith that we proclaim. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For one believes with the heart and so is justified, and one confesses with the mouth and so is saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and is generous to all who call on him. For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But how are they to call on one in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in one whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone to proclaim him? And how are they to proclaim him unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring good news. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Come for we invite you, guest and master.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side, while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time the boat, battered by the waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning he came walking toward them on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." He said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came toward Jesus. But when he noticed the strong wind, he became frightened and beginning to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Dear friends, as always, I speak to you in the name of the one who is our hope and salvation, Jesus the Christ. Amen. So here you have a really well-known story. A story of the boat getting in trouble on the waters and Jesus walking on the water early in the morning and coming to the disciples. I want to back up a little bit because I want to remind you where we've been in the story that Matthew's been unfolding. Jesus has fed the 5,000 plus women and children. That sense of miracle that we talked about last week has been done. He immediately tells his disciples to get in the boat and start heading back. And he goes off after dismissing the crowds by himself up the mountain to pray. Remember, he'd originally come to have some solitude, some time away, some time of retreat. And the crowds had found him and he had compassion on them and met their needs. But he still goes to spend time in prayer. And that's important because it reminds us that no matter how busy life is going or what's happening or how distracted we get or who interrupts what our plans are, we're still called to be persons who live in prayer. And that's not just the prayers we say, but it's an attitude that we take to find ourselves in the presence of the Holy that we can be restored and renewed. So Jesus goes up and he's praying. The disciples are heading out and they're going against the wind and making it nowhere. And they're in a storm and they're getting frightened. Perhaps they certainly get very frightened when Jesus comes to them on the water early in the morning. They're terrified, saying, "Is he a ghost?" And then he reveals himself to them in the midst of their storm, in the midst of their woes, in the midst of their terrors. I want to look at this story a little differently than sometimes we have, because often it's interpreted about in life, whenever we find ourselves in struggles, whenever we find ourselves in woes, whenever we find ourselves in terror, God will come and help calm things and restore us, and we need to be looking for that. I think that is a central truth to this story and a call of what this is about, but there's some things going on here. First, what is this appearance about? What is Jesus doing coming to them this way? He sent them on their own. And I remember a couple of things. One, when I was first ordained, Marlene and I spent time at Camp Knowles in Saskatchewan. We all seemed to get the sort of intermediate boys camp, and looking after them for a week drove us crazy. But in Saskatchewan, just like in Palestine, winds come up very quickly. So in the Sea of Galilee, winds can come up very quickly across over the wilderness and down onto the waters, and they can really roil things. So even though they were seasoned fishermen, someone on the boat, and knew what they were doing, you can still get caught in a storm. So there was this one camp where Marlene and I took the boys out in canoes. We were out in four canoes, and she was sort of shepherding two. I was shepherding two others. We went down. It was an absolutely beautiful day, easy paddling on the lake. But sure enough, the wind started to pick up all of a sudden out of nowhere, and we turned and we're heading directly back into it. And my two canoes are doing just fine, and I look back, and the two canoes with Marlene are falling further behind. And so I went back to try and help her out, and her canoe was fine, so she went up and caught up with the other canoe of my two that was doing well, and she shepherded them to shore. I had to go back and catch this other canoe where all the kids had just given up. They stopped paddling. They just sat there, and the wind's blowing the canoe down. So we caught up with them, with my team, and we put on a line, and we're paddling back against all the waves, and I suddenly realized I was the only one paddling. None of the other kids were. And no matter how I controlled them, they wouldn't do it. So my plan was just to go into shore, make them wave the canoes all the way back along the shore for about half a kilometer back to camp. When just at that point, a motorboat came by and said, "Would you like a little help?" And I said, "Yes." And so we got a tow back, and we actually beat Marlena back, and she looked at me with a lot of chagrin, saying, "How come you got a boat to tow you?" Winds come up. We don't know what's going to happen. We do all the planning we can do, and we get ourselves caught. That's part of what's going on here. When we're caught, do we think about God being present with us? Or are we, like Jesus' friends, absolutely astounded and in terror and frightened when God shows up in the midst of our woes and cares? Like, what are you doing here? Why are you here where I'm in despair and need? That motorboat coming was a sense of a lift of spirit and hope. What do we look for when we're in terror, when the waters are roiled? What do we look for in our time now where things are roiled and things are in trouble? Do we expect the appearance of God, the presence of God? But Jesus comes to them and they're terrified. They don't expect him to be there. It's one of those times where they sort of go, "What the heck are you doing here? How did this happen?" And in that moment, he reveals himself to them. And then Peter says, Peter, the spontaneous one, "If it's you, command that I come to you." And it's one of those favorite parts when you're a kid, this walking on water. I remember that phrase always, and it was instilled into me early as a child, with all things. All things with God is possible. All things with God are possible. And I thought about this walking with water when I was a kid, and I went, "Really?" And I don't know if you did such things, but I would practice walking on water at the lake, running down the dock, and then seeing how many steps I could take in the water before I sunk. Usually two or three, and I ended up on my face. But the whole business there was what is this about? Is this about Peter's faith? And here maybe we need to step back a little bit too and say, how do we encounter Jesus in the readings of the Gospels and in the readings of Scripture? I think one of the greatest things that happened with the Reformation was that we started to take Scripture seriously, but maybe also one of the worst things that happened with the Reformation is that we started to take Scripture seriously. And by that I mean that dour, serious preaching is that Jesus only went around without any humor, always giving object and moral lessons. When I see Peter spontaneous coming out of the boat to Jesus, I always see Jesus smiling and laughing when he sinks and going, "Peter, Peter, Peter, Peter." Can we see it that way? Or was he berating him for his lack of faith? I don't know. Maybe he was being more compassionate. Maybe he was being a little bit humorous. "Peter, Peter, Peter, where are you of little faith?" Remember, Jesus has spoken before about just a little faith will give you the power to move mountains. So I see him here perhaps being a little bit more joyful, a little bit more human, a little bit more teasing, a little bit more cajoling, and lifting Peter up. And I think maybe sometimes when we engage Scripture, we should at least look for the possibilities of the humor in God and of the presence of God. For if we have that, God must have that as well. So however we want to take this text, the call is for us to think about our lives. Think about our lives in the full, when they're going smoothly, when they're in rough waters. How do we encounter God? How do we expect to see God? Or do we expect to see God? And I think faith is that we should expect to know the presence of God in all facets of our life. I remember that wonderful story about the person needing a parking space because they were running very late for an appointment in this large city They're praying to God all along, saying, God, I hope that you'll get me a parking space. I really need a parking space. And just as they're coming up to the building where they're going, somebody was pulling up, and they said, oh, don't worry about it, God, I found my home. Sometimes we forget that the presence of God with us needs to be celebrated. We aren't on our own, and we shouldn't dismiss God from the facets of our life when we think that we've accomplished things by ourselves. I think as persons of faith, we need to walk with God and know it is with God that we do all things. Not separate from, not to prove ourselves to God, but with God. And that's the final image and the most loving image that I see in this story. Peter with Jesus as Jesus reaches down and lifts him out of the water and holds him back to the boat, and all things are calm and they get on their way where they need to be. I'll leave it there, but as you engage the scriptures, I always invite you to think from different angles, to think from different ways, and to think into your life and to ask yourselves, what do they say about the presence of God, the presence of Christ in my life? I invite us now to engage into a time of prayer. And let us pray with unwavering firmness and offer petitions for all in need as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. Holy One, hear our prayer. We pray for the world and all peoples of the earth, children of God and members of the human family. Let us pray as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. We pray for the work of the church throughout the world, remembering in particular this week in our worldwide Anglican Communion, the Anglican province of Rwanda. And we pray for the work of the churches in Lebanon and Beirut as they partner in the work to bring recovery to that devastated city and land. We pray within our Anglican Church of Canada for Linda, our primate, Mark, our national Indigenous Archbishop, Anne, our Metropolitan Archbishop. And within our Diocese of Niagara, we pray for our Bishop Susan and for the people of All Saints Lutheran Anglican Church in Guelph. And here at St. George's, we continue to pray in gratitude for all who are taking action to prevent further the spread of COVID-19. Let us pray as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. We pray for our good earth, that we may be vigilant stewards of its resources. We pray for the harvests that are happening at this time. We pray for those who work the land on our behalf. We pray for the birds of the air, the beasts of the field, the fish of the sea. Let us pray as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. We pray for all whose lives are marked by sickness and suffering, destruction and violence, strife and contention. We pray in particular for those who are marginalized, broken, forgotten, those who are the victims of violence, abuse, for those who reach out to them. And in particular, we pray this day for those who have requested particular prayers, remembering Ron, Vivian, Rod, Andy, Fred, Doug, Joe, Jim, Trevor, Ned, Ray, Joanne, Diane, Ted and Allison, Ross, Ian, Jim, Jean, Lori, and any others that you may wish to name now in silence or aloud before God. Let us pray as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. We pray for those who have died in the peace of Christ and for all that departed, especially for Nancy Johnson and for Cameron, and for strength and peace for their family and friends. Lifting our voices with all creation, with all the saints, with all who have shown us the light of Christ, may we be strengthened by their example and prayers. Let us pray as we say, Holy One, hear our prayer. God and parent of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, you give us a spirit of love and self-discipline. Hear our prayers for mercy and guard your people in times of trial. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior, and by the grace and strength of your Spirit. Amen. We come now to the time where we share a sign of peace. And as we come to share that sign of peace, I do want to make a little shout out, because she told me not to, which I'm not sure whether that means do it or don't do it, but tomorrow is Marlena's and my 35th wedding anniversary, so happy anniversary, Marlena. She's known me for over 50 years, so she should have known before we got married what she was getting into, but anyway, happy anniversary, Marlena, love of my life and delight of my heart. My friends in Christ, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
Continue with the prayer after communion. All your works praise you, O God, and your faithful servants bless you. Gracious God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we who share his body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so that we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name, through Christ our Savior. Amen. Once again, I want to thank Jerry and Ian for being here and providing such wonderful music, for Elizabeth being here to read, Laura looking after our production, Tony looking after all our cleaning needs, and to all of you for tuning in and being present with us. We are working our plan for our slow, gradual reopening in September, and it'll be very limited, and we'll let you know what we can do. But all of that will be unfolding in the next couple of weeks, and once our plans are approved, we'll be able to go fully ahead and restore some in-person worship. But we will continue indefinitely into the future having the live stream on Sundays. The time might change, but we're going to keep that going as well. And don't forget that we have our project while we're away and yet still gathered, to support the needs into the world. Our partners through Climate World Relief and Development Fund, and we've raised thousands, but we'd like to raise more. Some of those things will be matched by Canadian government, and it seems good for us to do that. We also gave money locally in support of COVID-related relief, and we are very generous in doing that from our outreach and social justice funds. So remember what Ian just sang in the words of that last hymn. We go to be the hands of Christ, to scatter joy like seed, and all our days to cherish life, to do the loving deed. May the bringer of light bless you. May the light, bright Son of Mary bless you. May the light of Christ dwell in you, in all you do, and in all that you may become. May the way of Christ be the path you tread, and the kingdom of heaven be your home. And the blessing of our God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you this day and forever. Amen.